Jesus Uncensored. Say that with me. Jesus Uncensored. Amen. And if you're new to us on today, we have this beautiful backdrop, a very profound statement being made in that the world seeks to censor the message of Jesus Christ. It means to change and to edit it and direct it in ways that somehow keep us distant from the Jesus that we need to know. But the cross is uncensored. Y'all missed what I said. The cross is uncensored. The cross is the truth. The cross is at the cross where we saw the light. And it is at that place where the message of Jesus Christ more and perhaps most profoundly was displayed and communicated. And we want to make sure that we get the whole Jesus. If you want Jesus, you got to take the whole Jesus. As we've been saying, everybody wants a Savior, but not everybody wants the Lord. And when Jesus is the Lord of your life, he can tell you what to do, where to go, how to talk, who to hang with, amen, somebody, how to dress, where you can go, where you can't go. If he's the Lord of your life, he's in control. And you can't have the Savior without the Lord. Acts chapter 2, verse 36, the Bible says, this Jesus whom you crucified, God has made both Lord and Christ. And so people knew in the first century when they accepted Jesus, they were accepting him as Savior and Lord. And so we have to make sure that we're doing the same thing. And by doing so, we have to be interested in the whole Jesus. And so what we've been doing is perusing through several statements of Jesus that have been considered by many as being very unpopular statements. Y'all know that Jesus has said some things that are not technically, culturally acceptable today. Amen. And some of these things that Jesus has said would get Jesus killed all over again today if he was here today. And so we tend to not want that Jesus, but we got to take the whole Jesus, as we've already been saying. So turn your Bible, if you will, to Matthew chapter 7. And what we've been doing over the last few weeks has been looking through the Sermon on the Mount. The Sermon on the Mount, we've been mentioning Jesus sits down with his disciples, and of course there was a larger audience who was privy to many of the teachings of Jesus, and this was one of the first times, I should say, where Jesus was communicating how his new humanity was going to function. There was a world, of course, but when the kingdom came to the earth through Jesus Christ, it would function under a different set of standards. Amen, somebody? Okay, a different set of standards. So Jesus was teaching a different way of thinking, behaving, and functioning in this new establishment, the kingdom, i.e. the body of Christ, i.e. the church. So Matthew chapter 7 and verse 24, if you had it, say amen. And here's what the Bible says. We're just going to look at this piece right here for your consideration. Jesus says this, therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. Now, every Sunday school teacher in here has taught this lesson. But I want you to look this morning at the true challenge of this text. I'm going to read this one more time. Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. This morning, I want to preach to you on the subject, can you stand the rain? Can you stand? Now, I know where you're lying. I'll talk to one of y'all soon to be elders, and he said, it sounds like somebody else. can you stand the rain? How many of you know that life can be difficult?
Yes, it can.
How many of you know that Sometimes in life, we don't know what's going to happen. Life can be very unpredictable. And I believe that what Jesus wants all of us to understand is in the times of unpredictability, if you will, that there is a word that can help us be the kind of stable kingdom citizens that God wants us to be. Most often in life, we can be filled with so many different kinds of foundational principles. There are some people who seek to gain wisdom from secular sources. There are some that seek to gain wisdom from things that make you feel good. But I believe we're living in a time where we've got to be interested on stuff that's going to hold us. Y'all know some of us have a certain vernacular in relationships, but I'm going to hold you down. And we don't mean oppressive. We mean in a supportive way. I got your back. I'm going to hold you down. Anybody heard that phrase being used before? I'm going to hold you down. You know, we together. There are some things that if you don't have held down in your life, that you'll find yourself being blown to and fro like a leaf in the middle of a hurricane. And so many people communicate this idea of assurance that oftentimes is not connected with the Word of God. And I want you to know that Jesus, it was important for him to say the right things, but he said those things with an anticipation that you would take them and do the right thing. Amen, somebody. He's expecting us to do the right thing. And for the Jesus that we often see today, many folks want the Jesus that says the stuff that, you know, we like to hear, but we do the things we want to do. I mean, if you found that sometime as a child, that when your parents say certain things you want to do and certain things you don't want to do, we're often inclined to do the stuff we want to do. And we even deal with our parent, our Father God, sometime in the same way. That he has a myriad of things for us to do, which really all boils down to love, believe it or not. But sometimes even love, we found this last week, sometimes even love hurts. So how can we get ourselves fastened to the Jesus of expectation? There's a couple of things that you need to see as we look through this particular text. As I've been mentioning to you, and however you stand on the fence with this, Jesus from Matthew 5-7, the Sermon on the Mount, some believe that maybe it was one whole long sermon, and then some believe it's a collection of sermons from Jesus in the same geographical place that have been compiled together through Matthew 5-7. Wherever you stand on that, the conclusion of his teachings are right here in Matthew chapter 7. And what Jesus does is he ends his series of lessons, if you will, by forbidding two, everybody say two. He's forbidding two characteristics that are sure to cripple his present and future audience. Now, y'all see this. Chapter 5 and chapter 7, he's teaching these principles. But he recognizes there are two things that can potentially cripple the people who are listening to his message. Those two things are legalism and laziness. Everybody say legalism. Everybody say laziness. What I mean by legalism, it is, and there's a lot of different ways to define it, but the one we'll use this morning is this notion that if one has a strict discipline to the letter of the law, that he is somehow made right. And rightness is based upon one's ability to follow rules. And so a legalistic person is a person that looks at the Bible document as a book of rules and not a means to have a relationship with Jesus. Are y'all following this? Okay. It's again, like I said, I've used an example before when I met Sister Anderson. When I first met her, I didn't ask her what the rules were to get in the relationship. I had to learn about who she was And when I learned about who she was and got closer to her, I realized what the standards were. And a person who has a legalistic mindset is a person who approaches even God himself from a rules perspective and not relationship perspective. This is a person who is so interested in Scripture that they are not interested in the voice who gave the Scriptures. And so what Jesus is doing, he knows he's communicating to an audience that is very legalistic. I've told you all through this series, the Pharisees were a group of people that were so legalistic that when it came to the heart of God, the heart of compassion, of grace and mercy, it was absent. And they only dealt with people based upon who could follow the rules and who couldn't. And Jesus knows these kind of people are in his audience. And so what he does, and I want you to go read this on your own time, before he gets to this verse, before we get to this verse, he said, many people will say to me, Lord, on that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? Have we not cast out demons? Have we not done this and done that? And then Jesus says, and I will say to them, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I never knew you. Now, why would Jesus say that to a person who did all the right things? Because it's very easy to do Jesus' work without having Jesus' relationship. Lord, have mercy. You can come to church and sing and pray and commune and give and listen to the word of God and not have a relationship with Jesus. Okay, Lord have mercy. You can come to all the service events. You can come to the building every time the doors are open. You can come and assist and work in every area that you possibly can and somehow do all of that and not even know Jesus. How do I know? Folk do it all the time. How do I know? Because there will be people who work real hard, and then when there's a moment for compassion to be displayed, they don't have it. Y'all follow what I'm saying to you? And so Jesus is saying, there's a whole lot of you that are going to come to me on the last day and say, hey, I know I'm coming in here because I did this, and I did this, and I did this, and I did this. And Jesus is going to say, yeah. And watch this now. He says, you'll do it in my name. And Jesus is going to say, yeah, but we don't have no relationship. Everything you did was about you. Y'all follow this? So he's dealing with the legalists by helping them understand, don't take all the stuff I've been preaching from Matthew 5 to Matthew 7 and get in your mind, if I just go do all these things, I'll be all right. Jesus is saying, I want you to do this stuff, but make sure you're in a relationship with me. Because I'll keep you humble when you work. Anybody here ever been disappointed? Somebody didn't value you and appreciate you. Listen, if you got a relationship with God, you don't need no hand, you don't need a pat on the back, you don't need a certificate or appreciation. When you're doing it for God, everything will be all right. So he's dealing with legalists first. But now what he's getting ready to do is deal with laziness. Because you can have a relationship with Jesus and not do any of this stuff. So I believe we've been teaching grace long enough. I think we got this thing about legalism, but now we want to get into this laziness aspect. Amen, somebody?
Amen.
All right. Look back at verse 24. So now Jesus is dealing with the people. He's already dealt with the people who are going to go do all the stuff and not have a relationship. Now he's going to deal with the people who have a relationship, but they don't want to do the stuff. Watch this, verse 24. Therefore, whoever what?
Hears.
Come on, whoever what?
Hears.
Whoever hears, get this down. Whoever hears these sayings of mine. What sayings? Everything I've been saying on the Sermon on the Mount. Whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him, or I will make a comparison, if you will, with a wise man who built his house on the rock. Let's keep going. Verse 25. The man built the house on the rock, and the rain descended. The floods came, and the winds, what is the text here, y'all? The winds blew. We got rain, we got floods, and we got winds. They blew and beat on that house, and it did not fall. For it was founded on the, everybody say the, on the rock. Look at verse 26. I gotta give you this whole thing so you can see where we're going. But now, everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like, Jesus said, I'm making a comparison with them too. I'm not comparing them to the wise man now, I'm comparing them to a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat on that house, and it fell. And look at Jesus. And great was his fall. Now that you see the picture, I want you to see the picture. Let's talk about rocks for a moment. This is a photo of a first century home, what's left of it, if you will. And those of you who know a little bit about geography or who taught geography, you know that there are different kinds of grounds, if you will. There are some places where there is what we call bedrock. Everybody say bedrock. Yeah, bedrock is simply that. It's a bed of rock. It's the kind of foundation that is only rock. And what people would do is they would build their houses on these kind of rocks. They would hewn in certain things that they could use to keep the house stable in times of difficulty. You gotta understand that a lot of this particular area, especially where Jesus is teaching in the Palestine area, the Galilee, etc., it was mostly desert. And so there was a lot of sand everywhere. You didn't just want to build, even now, for example, where I grew up in Kansas City, most houses, 98% of the houses that we had basements. Then I moved here and I went to some of y'all houses and I said, where's the basement? They said, we don't have a basement. I said, no basement. How do you have a house with a basement? I mean, everybody's house had a basement. It was like a second home, if you will. And then I started learning about the geography in this particular region. We faced it just a few months ago. We had, those of you who remember our renovation work, we had some foundational issues in our foyer. Why? Because there's a certain kind of foundation in this region where it just sinks. There's folk in this city that make all kind of money based upon these geographical issues. There are companies who have this stuff that they can run underneath concrete that is broken and kind of lift up a whole foundation. Why? Because the foundation here is such where you got to be very careful about these things if you're going to make a $100,000 investment. And even back at this time, folks realized you just don't go build your house on whatever you want to. It would be unwise to build your house on whatever you wanted to. So people would take their time and find the right spot, and they would do this thing that you're seeing right here on the screen. They would make sure that they build their house on something sturdy, on something that is promising. Now help you, let me help you with this. The rock represents a few things, y'all. Number one, the rock represents Christ as the foundation. Here's what Jesus is saying. The stuff I'm saying to you about how to live your life, Jesus will say, about how to treat people, he blessed all the poor, blessed all the meek, all those things that he said, those things can become so profound in your life that it functions like a rock. And when you are built upon Jesus, you are the kind of person that never has to rely upon yourself. Anybody here, you glad that you can lean on Jesus? I was having a Bible discussion with someone the other day, and they said, well, you know, after I showed them something in Scripture that they perhaps didn't know or I disagreed with, they were like, okay, well, so you're saying, and what I hear you're saying, I said, no, I'm not saying. Jesus said. It's really cool when you get to have a discussion like that, because you just get to kind of step out of there and let Jesus handle it. So when you have Jesus as your foundation, you don't have to trust in yourself. You can be like the Proverbs said, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding. Amen, somebody. You ought to be able to do in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path. I don't have to lean on me. I can lean on Jesus. And so Jesus is saying, take the stuff that I'm saying, and I want you to do what I say. And when you do what I say, I become your foundation. It's like building your house, building who you are on me. It also implies an idea of preparation. A person who builds their house or their life, if you will, on the rock is a person who actually thinks about this. For example, when a person was building their house upon the rock, they had to make sure they found the right place. When they found the right place, they had to be strategic about how the house was built. They had to pay attention to the different things that they may often lose in translation. They had to make sure that they were prepared. And one of the things I want you to understand is that you don't know when winds are going to blow in your life. Some of you in here, stuff happens to you, and it was so uncalculated, and it was like, there's a saying in, which I know all these names, in people who study weather, that sometimes it's what you call the perfect storm. It's when the perfect climate and the perfect season and the perfect circumstances come together, and we don't mean perfect in a good way, we mean perfect in a complete way, that certain things have come together the right way for the wrong things to happen. And some of our lives are like that. Some of us right now, you're in the middle of a perfect storm that the devil presented the right stuff with the right people in the wrong season, and it all came together, and it feels like it's all going on you. And I'm suggesting to you that a person who builds their house upon a rock is a prepared person. They're saying, I don't know when, I don't know how, but I know when it comes, I'm going to be all right because I'm standing on Jesus. And see, that's a much different kind of life than the person who lives without Christ, and we'll get into that in just a moment, because they seem to try to calculate the storms. But I know even since living here in Montgomery, we experienced this back in Kansas. The weatherman will tell you tomorrow, it'll be sunny, 86 degrees, no rain in the forecast. The next day, it rained all day. The assurance of safety. When your house is built on the rock, you don't like the wind, you don't like the waves, you may not like the rain, but you never fear that it's going to affect you in a way that's going to move you from your relationship with Jesus. The beauty of having a house built upon the rock or doing the things that Jesus says is it's going to lead to the assurance of safety. I know everything is going to be okay. Amen, somebody? Jesus said it's not enough just to hear. And let me add this one on here. It's not enough, and in this day and time, it's very popular for people to just hear what Jesus is saying, but not feel the need to do what he says. But hearing and doing must come together if you're going to have the benefits of being prepared and having the assurance of safety. Amen? Let's talk about sand. Anybody ever experienced building a sand castle on the edge of the beach? And it's impossible for me with little children not to go to the beach and someone attempt to build a sandcastle. And my kids can use anything they can. You know, they try to get a cell phone if they can, scrape up sand. I mean, anything they can to put something together. And what's interesting is that that the older they get, the more they begin to understand. But the younger ones will be building this sandcastle like right up on the water. And I go, you know, no, stop. Go back. It's not going to work. And they go, I'm building my. And so they get going over this thing. And then a good wave will come in, wash the whole thing away. And as silly as that sounds, a whole lot of us do that every day. That we don't take the time to do things Jesus' way, but we expect Jesus' benefits. Let me tell you about the sand. The sand, to Christ, what it represents is feelings. In other words, sometimes I may not feel like doing what Jesus wants me to do. But I want you to understand, your feelings are not more important than what Jesus says. And sometimes your feelings are the very reasons why we get swept away in the wind and in the waves. Feelings or the house, listen, building a house on the sand is actually easier than building a house on the rock. Why? Because for one of them, it takes as much work. Building a sandcastle and building a house on the rock is a completely different type of labor. It's easy. And in the world that we live in, folks want easy Jesus. You know, I don't want the hard stuff. I don't want to be loving people who hate me. I don't want to do all that. I just want to do something easy. That represents your feelings. It also represents poor preparation. Person who builds a house on the sand looks just as silly as a child building a sandcastle right next to the water. It is inevitable that at some point the whole thing is coming down. Watch this, another part of it is the house on the sand represents self-assurance. In other words, it represents that I know what Jesus says, I know I'm not prepared as I should be, but I just believe I'm going to make it. Well, listen, my friends, at some point, you face challenges that are bigger than you. And there are some things only Jesus can do. And when you don't prepare properly, it allows the devil to take advantage of certain things in your life that he never would be able to do if you had a house built upon the rock. I want to close with this thought, verse 25. I want y'all to see this. And the rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house. Let me tell y'all something. Whether your house is built on the rock or whether it is built on the sand, let me help you. Rains are coming. Floods will come. Wind is going to blow. And this is very important for us to understand as Christians, because a lot of folks think that just because you're in Christ that you're not going to face those storms. Some of the biggest struggles can be with new Christians who have dealt with a life of difficulty and challenges, and then they come into Christ and they expect all of a sudden for there to not be any difficulty. Listen, sometimes it gets worse before it gets better. I want you to understand that being in Christ doesn't mean you're not going to face any more storms. Being in Christ means you're going to face sometimes the very same storms you dealt with before you told Jesus, I do. The question is, however, what are you standing on? Watch this now. It did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. Listen, but everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain descended. Y'all see it? And the floods came. And the winds blew and beat on that house and fell. And Jesus says, and great was its fall. I believe Jesus says that great was his fall because a lot of us don't realize just how bad of shape we can find ourselves in without Christ. It's not just a fall. It's a great fall. Amen. You might have had one in your life, a great fall. But there's a fall and then there's a great fall. And what Jesus is communicating is that if we are sure to stand on the rock, everybody say stand on the rock. If we are sure to stand on the rock, then everything is going to be okay. But standing on the rock is just the same as doing those things that Jesus wants us to do. And you got to ask yourself, are you in a relationship with Jesus to do what he wants done? Or do you just want his Savior-like mentality? And doing what he wants you to do leads to the kind of life that keeps you connected with God in the strongest way you possibly can be. Amen, somebody? Amen. If you're here this morning and you're not in a relationship with Jesus, you ought to take care of that this morning. We believe that God is a good God. But because God is good, his nature is such where he's only good. He can't be anything else other than good. And since he's good, and since he's righteous, God is justified in punishing anything that is opposite of his own nature. So how does a God who has to justifiably punish sin allow sinners to be in a relationship with him? He sent Jesus. Jesus took the brunt of the punishment. He became sin, yet he did no sin. And all of this he did is so that you could be in a relationship with God himself. And if you believe this, you may be a Christian even on this morning, hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ, believing God is who he said he is, repenting, changing your mind, saying yes to God and no to yourself, confessing Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10, that Jesus died on the cross and was buried and rose from the grave, and being baptized for the remission of your sins, Acts chapter 2 and verse 38. This opportunity of salvation is yours if only you would say yes and be baptized today. But if you're here this morning and you need prayer, perhaps you're going through one of these storms we're talking about, we want to pray and encourage you to leave this place doing